Morning, everyone. I don't do the clap so that to wake you up. It's just because I'm recording the audio on here and the video on there. It just means that's what. Did you know that's why they do the thing in films, just to synchronise the audio and the video? Did you know that? I never knew that until I started doing this kind of thing. Does anyone have any nice news for us this morning?
Oh, it's all bad.
It's all bad news. I know. Well. Oh, Eileen, you've got, yeah?
My checking, I get off at night, Georgia, is going to come. And another baby boy, and another baby boy, next February.
Well, that's lovely news.
Well, Teddy's been saying for 2 years, I need somebody to play with.
Oh, yes. So she's finally alive now.
Yes, they had... you may be referring to, Jan, they had on the news earlier that about the restrictions from Monday about the meetings of six. I think the government have been very unclear about what is and isn't allowed. Some people say this is only about just formalising the guidance. So the guidance was that only people from six people should meet, but it was legal for up to 30 to meet. And I think what they're doing is just making that more formal. And someone said earlier, and this was a bishop, someone who should know that this won't apply to churches. So we should still be able to keep meeting. So I hope that, but do keep your eyes, keep your eyes out, because I think it's just for the informal settings, really. So there we go. Beth, I mean, I think it's the COVID secure groups, isn't it? I would await further guidance about Bethany. Mm-hmm. There we go. What can we say? Just something for prayer, I think. And if you're like me, sometimes you just have to scratch your head at what's going on in the world and what the government are doing. And I think, the main thing is just to keep trusting, keep praying, and, because God can change things even if we can't. Let's hope that things do change for the better. But there we go. We remember that God is still the Lord. And we saw that last week. We were thinking about Psalm 2, weren't we? And perhaps let's begin with the psalm, in fact, because that's what we usually do in Wednesday worshippers. So you don't have Bibles there, but I will read out Psalm 82, which was my psalm for this morning. And perhaps if you'd like, and you remember, we could join in with the Gloria at the end. This is Psalm 82, a psalm of Asaph. God presides in the great assembly. He renders judgment among the gods. How long will you defend the unjust and show partiality to the wicked? Defend the weak and the fatherless. Uphold the cause of the poor and the oppressed. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. The gods know nothing. They understand nothing. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I said you are gods. You are all sons of the Most High, but you will die like mere mortals. You will fall like every other ruler. Rise up, O God, judge the earth, for all the nations are your inheritance. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Amen. I think the good news, isn't it? That although we may look around and we may see, certainly when we look around the world, we see governments and rulers doing, oppressing the poor, the weak and the needy, but we know that God will judge, and God is the just judge, and he will act. And that's good news for us. Well, we're going to have a song to start with, and I really am sorry that we can't all sort of sing in the normal way, But I've chosen a song which I think is just a nice, quiet, reflective one, just helping us to remember this is Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. And you have got hymn books. I've cleared it with Mark, just that if it should be okay, so long as we leave them, you know, obviously in between, so it should be safe. So that's okay. It's number 40 if you want to look at the words. I know some of you will know anyway. Be still for the presence of the Lord. And it's good to remember that whether we can sing or not, that God's presence is still here. Be still for the presence of the Lord. It's number 40 in the books if you want to follow. Grace, and that's what we remember particularly in the communion, as Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me, remembrance of him dying and giving his life, that we might be forgiven and that we might live. And that's what we remember in the prayer of preparation, as we ask God to cleanse our hearts, and that we might love him and magnify, praise his holy name. Let's pray together the prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, the fountain of all goodness, bless our Sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth, and all who are in authority under her, that they may order all things in wisdom and equity, righteousness and peace, to the honour and glory of your name and the good of your church and people. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we're going to have our Bible reading this morning, and Steph is going to come and bring us our Bible reading. It's on your sheets. You should have a sheet with the reading there from the book of Ecclesiastes. We're going to start a new series today looking at the book of Ecclesiastes. I'll let Steph read it for us.
Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 1 to 11. The words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What do people gain from their labours, at which they toil under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets, and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they return again. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear is full of hearing. But what has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, this is something new? It was here already long ago. It was here before our time. No one remembers the former generations. And even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we're going to look at that passage in just a moment's time. But before we do that, let's stand and we'll say together the Nicene Creed as we declare our belief in one God, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, in common with all Christians for generations. Let's say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And please do be seated, and if you have that little bit of paper with Ecclesiastes, you might want to have that in front of you. Well, one of the things which, we were talking a little bit about this last week, but one of the things which is just, you know, true about our society is that we are, by and large, as a society, scared of talking about death. You know, no one wants to face it. No one wants to talk about it. And I think that's why the whole COVID situation has had such an impact, because it's brought to mind things which people would rather not think and talk about. People just don't like talking about death, do they? And I notice this when I do funerals for people. Generally, people they just want to get it over and done with, and they want to get their grieving done, and then they almost pretend it never happened. Apart from the fact that, you know, someone has died, they just don't want to face it. They don't want to face the fact of whatever they think about death. And this is why I think Ecclesiastes is a really important book for us to be looking at now. Because Ecclesiastes is a book which, in a sense, is all about death, or rather, it's all about how death and thinking about death in the right way should help us to live our lives. It should teach us, in fact. Death should be our teacher. I read a book not too long ago, which was based on Ecclesiastes, called Living Life Backwards. And I can really recommend it if you want to get into Ecclesiastes. And I borrowed the headings and the passages from that book for the purposes of this. So if you want to study in more depth Ecclesiastes, Living Life Backwards is a really good book to get. So let's dive in and let's think about this briefly. Ecclesiastes, it said, it's the words of the teacher, the son of David, king of Jerusalem. Who is the teacher? And you might think, well, that's easy, isn't it? It's Solomon. And I mean, I think that's probably the most likely explanation. But there are a few things which it said in the book which do make it a little bit unclear. You know, I was king. Well, surely Solomon was king right up until he died. So why is it saying things like that? But either way, it doesn't really matter. I think it probably was Solomon. But at the end of the day, this is wisdom from God that's coming to us. Wisdom from God, and that's the important thing to understand. This is wisdom literature. And he starts out by saying, meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless, everything is meaningless. Actually, it just sounds like the kind of thing someone might say at the moment, doesn't it? You might hear someone saying that at the bus stop, or perhaps not using those exact words, but you know, that just sounds like the kind of thing someone might say at the moment. The word meaningless here, this is used more in the book of Ecclesiastes, about 30 times more than it's used in any other book in the Bible. In fact, I think about half of the times this word is used in Ecclesiastes. It means something like a breath or a vapour. So, you know, imagine if you're on a winter's day, you just go, and you see it appear for a moment and then disappear. That's the kind of thing that it means. So if you look, for example, Psalm 39 has this word in, and it's translated slightly differently there. It says, you have made my days a mere handbreadth. The span of years is as nothing before you. Everyone is but a breath. Everyone is but a breath. That's the same word. Everyone is, and it disappears. And that's the idea behind it. It's saying that vanity is the old word for it, you know, that our lives are just like that, and then they disappear. And that's the sense of what he's saying in Ecclesiastes. So he asks this question in verse 3. What do people gain from all their labours at which they toil under the sun? What's the point of it all? He's basically saying, what's the end result? What do we get from all of the hard work that we put in life? What's the point of everything? And this question is the foundation of everything that he says in the next, to the end, you know, to verse 11. The summary really is just that nothing changes. Now, things keep on going on and on and on. He says in verses 4 to 7, you know, the natural world continues. The generations come and go. the earth remains forever. The sun rises and it sets. The wind blows and north and south and goes round and round. The streams keep flowing into the sea, yet it's never full. So the natural world just carries on and on and on. And it sort of outlasts human life. You know, that whatever we do, our lives are here for a moment and then we're gone. And the natural world just continues. And he says in verse 8, all things are wearisome, more than one can say. It just wearies you with all of this kind of, these cycles, you know. It tires us out just by continuing, by being the same. And then he says, verses 9 and 10, that nothing genuinely new happens. You know, that what's happened will be again. What's been done will be done again. There's nothing new under the sun. That's a very famous verse, isn't it? Nothing new under the sun. And he just says, look, although things might seem to change, actually, at the end of the day, nothing really changes. Human beings are just human beings. We're just the same. Whatever happens, we are just the same. Human beings don't really change. And he finishes just saying that no one remembers former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. So each generation kind of comes and goes. No one really pays any attention. You think, you know, which of us remembers the generations that happened, you know, 5 generations ago, 10 generations, 15? They just came and went, and here we are, and soon will be forgotten by future generations. So is this, starting out, is the writer of Ecclesiastes, is Solomon or whoever it is, trying to make us depressed? Is that the point of all of this? Just to make us go, oh, what's the point? Now, I don't think that is the point. I think Ecclesiastes here is actually tapping into something. You know that song by the Rolling Stones, I Can't Get No Satisfaction? Do you remember that song? And I think that is true of a lot of people, actually, that whatever we try, whatever we do in life, we can't get any satisfaction. And at the end of the day, we're just going to die anyway. And then what? Then what will all of it be worth? And the point is that we are looking for something that can't be fulfilled in the things of this world. We human beings are looking for something that can't be ultimately fulfilled through the things of this world. You know that expression, death makes fools of us all. And you think about someone like Bill Gates, or is he the richest person in the world? I'm not sure who it is at the moment, but someone who's got, you know, piles of money. And you think about the poorest person in the world, and you think, what's the difference between them at the end of the day? They're just going to die and be forgotten. You know, that's the end of both of them, that we know for sure. And that's exactly what it says, actually, in the Psalms. Now, Psalm 49 verse 12, for example, I read this fairly recently, which says, Psalm 46, flip over the page, people, despite their wealth, do not endure. They're like the beasts that perish. That's our fate, isn't it? But this is what Ecclesiastes is saying, that we need a perspective change. We need a perspective change. Because with God in the picture, things are a bit different. You see, if we're always looking for satisfaction in the things of this life, if we're always looking for satisfaction in the here and now, in, you know, our work, in our possessions, in our families, all of those things, then we'll never be satisfied. And we'll keep looking for new things, but for novelty, for the next thing to satisfy us. This is actually, I found a quote from C.S. Lewis in the Screwtape Letters. I don't know if you've read this book. It's worth reading. C.S. Lewis, it's one of his most sort of playful books. But let me read you a little bit about, just to put it into context, if you haven't read it. This is what he imagined a demon writing to a sort of a sub-demon to try and you know, get his person away from God, you know, to try and keep him on the wrong paths. This is what he says. The horror of the same old thing is one of the most valuable passions we have produced in the human heart. An endless source of heresies in religion, folly in counsel, infidelity in marriage, and inconstancy in friendship. The humans live in time and experience reality successively. To experience much of it, therefore, they must experience many different things. In other words, they must experience change. And since they need change, the enemy, that's God, by the way, from the perspective of this book, being a hedonist at heart, has made change pleasurable to them, just as he has made eating pleasurable. But since he does not wish them to make change any more than eating an end in itself, he has balanced the love of change in them by a love of permanence. He has contrived to gratify both tastes together in the very world he has made by that union of change and permanence which we call rhythm. He gives them the seasons, each season different, yet every year the same, so that spring is always felt as a novelty, yet always as the recurrence of an immemorial theme. He gives them in his church a spiritual year. They change from a fast to a feast, but it is the same feast as before. And he goes on to say that we need to be the change and the rhythm that God gives. You know, we are to be pleased and get pleasure from that, but not see that as an end in itself. And you see this in the world, unfortunately, that people are constantly seeking after change and the new rather than just being satisfied with what God gives. So I'd just like to suggest a couple of lessons as we finish. The first thing is to give thanks to God in everything. To give thanks to God in everything, because God is the one who gives us the gifts, every good gift, day by day, whether that be, you know, the sun rising, the seasons changing, another meal. Now that's why Christians often say grace before meals. It's just to remind us that we give thanks to God in everything. And that's one way of taking a stand against always wanting the new thing, against novelty. But the second thing that we need to do is we need to seek him for the deeper meaning. Because all of these things, they don't have any meaning without God. You know, that without God, none of this really has any meaning. And this is what Ecclesiastes is saying. But actually, when we seek him, then he is the one who is able to give our daily lives meaning. And all of the things that we do day by day, all of the work that we do, all of those things, it has meaning with him. And that's what we need to look for. And hope that as we go through Ecclesiastes, that's something that we'll pick out a bit more. So I appreciate that this has been a brief sort of look at the beginning of Ecclesiastes, but I hope that these are things which we'll all look at as we, over the coming weeks, coming up to Christmas, obviously government permitting, that we're allowed to meet, that we will be thinking about. Well, we're going to come to our prayers now. And so we'll pray for, I think we'll pray for people who are struggling in this way. Ron said to me earlier that Pam's going in for her operation on Friday, and the operation is actually on Saturday, isn't it? So we'll pray for Pam and Ron, and pray that it will be good and successful. Operation. So we'll pray for them. And I think it's be good to pray for our country at the moment, you know, given what's happening and changing from Monday. I think a lot of people are really struggling at the moment. And so let's pray for them as well. And so Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this book of Ecclesiastes. And we thank you, Lord, that although it may be a book that we're a little less familiar with, we thank you for the message that you have for us from the book. And we pray that you would help us to take on board what you want us to hear over the coming weeks. And we pray that you would help us to be people who are grateful and thankful to you for every good gift that you give day by day, for the rhythm of our days. And we also pray, Heavenly Father, that you'd help us to be people who look to find our meaning in our lives in you. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would be with those in our town, in our parish, who perhaps don't look for their meaning in you. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that many people would come to seek you as the one who gives meaning to our lives, as the one who helps us. And we especially pray, Lord, at this time where so many people are struggling, and as we look next week to a tightening of restrictions, we do pray, Heavenly Father, that you would help us, especially those in our parish. We pray for friends and neighbours who are maybe struggling with not being able to get out or see friends or family that we want to, and be able to do the things that we normally do. So we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would help us to cope. And please help us, Lord, who have hope in you, to be able to talk to others about that hope as well. And we do pray, Heavenly Father, that you would give our government real wisdom and enable them to have courage to do what is right, to lead us through and hopefully out, we pray, of this time. And we do pray, Lord, for those who are in particular need of our prayers. And we just want to lift before you Ron and Pam this morning. And we pray for Pam's operation. Pray for her as she goes in to hospital on Friday, and then for the operation on Saturday. We pray that all of the preparations would go well, and that the operation itself would be successful. And we just pray, Lord, for safety for Pam. And we pray, Lord, that they would trust you and know that you are close to them and with them in everything that happens. And let's take a moment to pray for anyone on your hearts that you want to pray for, whether quietly or out loud. Lord, we do commit all of those that we've named to you, and all of those, Lord, in our church family who need our prayers today, and those friends and family we have. We thank you that you are a God who knows, that you are a God who cares, and that you can do, you are loving, and you can do all that you promise to do. So please be with us now and keep us, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we're going to, in our service sheets now, going to come to our confession as we begin the communion. And just again, a little reminder about communion. At the moment, we're only able to take the bread. And also, what I'll do is I will sanitise my hands. If anyone would like any sanitised before taking it, I know you've just done it on the way in, but I'll just offer, if anyone wants to, I can bring it round beforehand. I will bring it round to you. So let's join in the confession in a moment. I'll read the introduction, and then we'll join in with the confession in our service sheets. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we gather at the Lord's table, we must recall the promises and warnings given to us in the Scriptures. Let us therefore examine ourselves and repent of our sins. Let us give thanks to God for his redemption of the world through his Son, Jesus Christ. And as we remember Christ's death for us and receive this pledge of his love, let us resolve to serve him in holiness and righteousness all the days of our life. You then, who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbours and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking from this day forward in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge and lament our many sins, and the wickedness we have committed time after time, by thought, word, and deed, against your divine majesty. We have provoked your righteous anger and your indignation against us. We earnestly repent and are deeply sorry for these our wrongdoings. The memory of them weighs us down. The burden of them is too great for us to bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that from this time forward we may always serve and please you in newness of life, to the honour and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with heartfelt repentance and true faith turn to him, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And as we've just heard, God promises forgiveness to all those who truly turn to him. And these comfortable words are the promises of God to all those who turn. Hear the words of comfort our Saviour Christ says to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Hear what St. Paul says. This saying is true and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear what St. John says. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And let's pray together. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in your tender mercy gave your only Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, he instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, merciful Father, we humbly pray, and grant that we, receiving these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, according to your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way after supper he took the cup, and when he had given thanks he gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Amen. If anyone would like to hand sanitize, just give me a wave. I'm going to do it myself. the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let's pray the prayer that the Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. If you turn over on the back of your service sheets, we'll pray together the prayer after communion. Lord and Heavenly Father, we offer you, through your dear Son, Jesus Christ, this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by his merits and death, and through faith in his blood, we and all your church may receive forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and our bodies, to be a reasonable, holy and living sacrifice. Fill us all who share in this holy communion with your grace and heavenly blessing. Although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer you any sacrifice, yet we pray that you will accept this, the duty and service that we owe. Do not weigh our merits, but pardon our offences. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, we have one closing song. It's another fairly short one, and I chose this one because it sort of fitted in quite well, I think, with the message of Ecclesiastes. It's "No one but you, Lord." And I know we definitely, the St. Mark's people will know this. I'm not sure if it's St. John's one, but it's number 402 if you want to follow along. But it just says, "No one but you, Lord, can satisfy the longing in my heart. Only you can fill my deepest longing." And I just thought that's a really good message to take from Ecclesiastes at the end of the day, that although life continues and, you know, the cycle continues and it's, you know, it seems like everything is meaningless, only the Lord can fill our deepest longing. And so that's I thought, a good one to finish with. To present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen. Amen.